Mariana Mazzucato is a professor of economics at the University of Sussex and joins us now. Nice to see you. Bailouts.
Yeah.
Subject du jour. Everybody's wondering who's next. But basically your line is that we're tackling this problem the wrong way.
Yeah, I mean, Italy is next if Italy doesn't actually have a growth policy that actually works. And what I'm seeing in Europe is that all of a sudden we're talking about growth, but we're not actually talking about the concrete mechanisms to bring it about. So, I mean, Italy, for example, has different types of structural reforms it's engaging with, including privatization and labor market reforms, which actually it also did in the 1980s, but it, you know, it didn't bring growth. You don't have growth without investment, so we have to think about how can we actually kick off both private and public investment in Europe, and this will not happen currently because there's very little confidence of the business sector. I mean, we even see this in the UK, which really is only riding out the storm a bit because it actually has a central bank which appeases the bond markets. But growth in the UK is terrible, and we just heard early in the year that GE is pulling out of a plan to invest 100 million in offshore wind turbines here because it doesn't really see some sort of growth of the green agenda, if you want, in the UK. And all this is happening while our big competitors in the world, so China and Brazil, are actually investing massively. So we have the Chinese five-year plan investing $1.7 trillion in these five new emerging sectors, which include new generation IT, new engines.
You sound like Keynes. Is this a Keynesian policy
you're pursuing? It's more than Keynes. It's not just about fiscal stimulus. It's about competition. So we keep hearing that we have this imbalance in Europe because we have, you know, the strong Germany and the weak Greece. But why is Germany strong? It's not just strong because it, you know, held down wages during the Schroeder years. It's strong because it has one of the highest R&D GDP ratios. It's actually been spending in areas like human capital in different factors that increase productivity. It is one of the greenest countries in Europe in terms of its investments, and this is why it wins UK procurement contracts. So if we want the rest of Europe, so Portugal, Italy, Greece, and Spain, to grow and actually to have a post-crisis long-term recovery, not just these little blips that one day seem like they're there and then they're not, they need to invest.
The Hartz reforms delivered a great deal for Germany. They certainly brought down improved the productivity story significantly. Germany benefits from a cheap euro and a cost of capital coming out of the Landesbanks, which are incredibly competitive. Yes. There are a number of reasons why Germany is outperforming at the moment. Yes. Is that something that you can replicate elsewhere, because it doesn't sound like it?
I think what we need is a common European vision. So, for example, with the European Investment Bank, which all of a sudden people are talking about, which I think we should have been talking about for at least, you know, the last 2 years, and it's very good, and I welcome that we brought it into the picture. Again, the mechanisms need to be thought about. So, for example, most EIB investments need to be co-financed nationally. Greece has no money right now to co-finance those investments. So we actually need, for example, ECB bonds to co-finance EIB bonds.
Yep.
And there's actually no real discussion about that.
What should the money be spent on?
It should be spent on viable projects. So projects that there's different areas that should be spent on. I mean, you know, Greece and Italy, for example, have not been spending on sort of general areas of education, research, and human capital formation. We cannot expect, though, EIB bonds to be spending on that. That has to be coming from national treasuries, and that's why we need the growth to kick off so the treasuries actually have some money coming in from taxes. But what these EIB bonds could be spending on is, for example, in renewables. So sun in Greece, there's plenty of it. That should not just be about tourism.
Yep.
That could actually, you know, kick off, you know, real solar energy technology in Greece, which, by the way, Spain, which I think is the biggest tragedy in Europe, because Spain, unlike Greece and Italy, was investing before the crisis. I don't know if you've ever taken a train in Spain, but there was wind turbines everywhere, there were solar panels, they were making huge changes within cities, so Barcelona all of a sudden had a big biking program, and all that has gone down the drain because of austerity. So Italy, on the other hand, actually didn't have a proper, if you want, green plan. But so what we need is sort of a common vision that, you know, Europe has to compete internationally.
This is great, and it sounds fantastic on paper. The problem is, though, execution on the ground in these countries has been historically appalling. The political story and the bureaucratic story is such that getting from A to B to C is really difficult and involves quite a lot of expense just within the system. That's what Monti's trying to fix. That's what probably needs fixing in Greece as well. Isn't that the first job?
That's the first job, but don't forget that the first thing that, for example, Telecom Italia did when it was privatized in the 80s, in the early 90s in Italy, the first thing it did was cut its R&D spending. So, you know, privatization and these different types of structural reforms which Monti is engaging with, which I'd say most of which I agree with, especially some of the labor market reforms, are not enough on their own. And because we also have strong austerity, currently all we're sort of seeing is falling demand and falling certainty, if you want, from the private business. So it's just not picking up, and it won't pick up until we actually make these investments. But as you say, there's a problem. These countries have no money, so how will those investments actually occur? And that's why you need to actually talk about the details. So, you know, you don't just talk about the EIB. You have to start thinking about how can we actually organize these EIB bonds to be co-financed by the European Central Bank bonds, or also having a proper common European banking authority, which, you know, because currently what we have is international banks, which then, you know, go bust and have to be bailed out nationally. That doesn't make any sense. Right, so these are international players who make all sorts of speculative investments all over the place, and then Spain has to, you know, bail out its bank, which then we get this circular thing where the banks are bailing out the governments then bail out the banks. It's just not going anywhere.